Good morning. It's always wonderful to hear our bell ring, which has been ringing for over 100 years in this spot. At this time, I invite everybody to prepare your hearts and minds for worship. Approximately 10 turkeys to do that and side dishes. And of course, if we don't have that many people come here that day, we've already worked out arrangements to take the remaining food we have to one of our local shelters. Be happy to have something like that. Let me ask you right now if we have any other announcements, and then I'll introduce some guests. Okay. All right. And this ties into one of the guests. Emily, when you have talent, you just got to watch it. You show up and people say, hey, we need you. And so Emily's going to do our offertory today. And that's a real blessing. So, of course, I would like to introduce the Sharp family. We can call them guests. It's definitely nice to have you each time that you're here. And I feel a little bit off the spot because when Emily was our youth director in the past, I helped her out a lot.
And choir director.
And she's a choir director. She had a lot of jobs, I remember that. And then Jason is a pastor. It's like, uh-oh. So, and I'll be on tape, too. So, anyway, I'll do that. And I'm very pleased to introduce my sister, Caroline. Caroline Ramsey. She grew up in this church. I talked about, Marguerite Reynolds was her Sunday school teacher. Oh, Laura Jean Coons was her Sunday school teacher. Marguerite was my Sunday school teacher and one of the higher grades. So it's good to have her back. She lives in the Columbus area. And so, does anybody else have any other guests that we should introduce or anything that you just want to say before we get started? Okay, very good. And our call to worship this morning is in the hymnal. It's hymn number 99. We'll have it on the screen. It's already there. It's called My Tribute, to God Be the Glory, and I'd like everybody to stand as able to sing this hymn. Do you really think that you are nothing special in the eyes of the Lord? Well, you're wrong. You are the light of His eyes, and He's made you the light of the world.
You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world.
We
concerns for the week. Let's start out with the joys. Is there anybody who has something addition to having guests with us? Yes, ma'am.
Well, just a little bit of both.
Okay.
My son has a house in Fort Myers.
Mm-hmm.
And so for a week or so, there was a lot of concern because it was headed straight for it. It came, it went, and the joy is all they did was lose a few shingles.
Okay. Good to hear. Okay, and any others?
So the reason we're here today is we're on vacation. We always take vacation around this time of year because it's our anniversary on October 1st.
Okay.
17 years ago, we got married right up there.
So I remember.
I still have fond memories of also proposing to Emily right up there. And then a couple of Sundays later, being able to hear you all hoot and holler as I announce
right.
Our impending marriage, so
yeah.
it's a lot of good memories.
It's great to have this building has a lot of family memories for many of us, and have you as part of our extended church family. Let me go ahead and announce a concern that we have. A lot of you have already found out from the email, but our sister Jane, who does so much with the finances for the church, suffered a fall, broke her hip. She was actually in Corbin, Kentucky when that happened. And she is back in town. She's back at home now. But it'll take a while for her recovery. Her family indicates that she's recovering quite well. And I know that if she could, she would be with us this morning. And likely she'll see this on the YouTube when it's posted. And so, Jane, we're praying for you and look forward to having you come back. Are there any other concerns that we want to bring up this morning?
My son has to have an easement.
Okay, right. You were telling me about that, Connie. So we'll put your son on the list.
He's not even 50 yet.
Okay. Well, I will tell you, the medical technology keeps getting better and better for those kind of things. We'll go to Tammy first, and then I'll get to you.
Okay. My mom, she's now in signature after spending 10 days in the hospital, and the cancer is just taking over her body. It's showing up in other places, so keep her in your prayers.
All right, Tammy, we certainly will. Okay.
I just wanted to continue prayers for the McDonald family. My cousin passed away a week ago Friday.
Okay.
His memorial service was yesterday at Heed Wright in Frankfort. And it's been a very tragic, sad death to a young, vibrant person to pass of cancer. It's
yes.
Just very difficult.
Okay. All right. Any others? Okay. That being the case, let's at this time join our hearts in prayer and we will transition from this prayer to the Lord's Prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the things that we can call our praises. We have people that are visiting, people that are renewing and fondly remembering their time as parts of the church family, and they are still very much part of the church family. We thank you for those of our members and relatives of our members who have come through the weather, the hurricane in Florida, as well as they have. And Heavenly Father, we also bring to you a list of concerns. We have medical procedures coming up. We pray for those who are bedridden with cancer and fighting the valiant fight, and know that that's in your hands, dear Lord. And we also pray for the Dahl family. And all of these things, we ask for your help. And we ask that you give any of the doctors discernment as they treat the individuals who need the medical treatment. And we'll join our voices together and pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
For our offering this morning, Larry, I hate to give you short notice, but could you assist in gathering the plates? Can I ask you to do that? And Mark, if you come forward.
Really swear the white minister has all that coordinated beforehand. So. Pastor Jim will be back next week.
Okay,
and Emily?
Oh, good.
There you are. Okay.
All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that you use these gifts, thy bounty, and that you we return a small portion of what you give to us. Amen. Father, please accept these gifts as a portion of thy bounty, which we are now returning to you. Amen. Hey, please be seated. And at this time, the last administrative council meeting we had, the council was about to decide on how they wanted the Christmas offering to be used this year. And what the people on the administrative council decided was that they wanted to have a vote for everybody that was present at church on the 9th of October. And so as our youth make their way to the back rooms for children's worship, at this time, Larry and Mark are going to bring around some index cards, and just as a few suggestions, the voting is open for anything, but in the past, we have used a Christmas offering for a Christmas family. We've done that. We've used Christmas offering for the United Methodist Committee on Relief, which is UMCOR. We have used the Christmas offering to donate to a local charity. There have been some years we felt that we just needed to use the Christmas offering to stay within the church. Those suggestions, any one of those would be sufficient. Any of you also might have some other ideas. And so at this time, our ushers will bring around cards, and they've got pencils if you need those, for you to just write down your idea on what would be the best use of our Christmas offering for this year. Okay. And I was very proud of the Administrative Council when they made that decision. Of course, a lot of you were at that Administrative Council meeting when we decided that we wanted to put it open to the church. But it's just a case of where we try to have a representation of everybody on the in the congregation when we do those kind of meetings. But there are some things that we should get input from everybody. So I do thank you for taking the time to work through that. Mark, actually, you can just leave those on the table in the back, and Larry will do the same thing. And if anybody's taking a little more time to think through that, you can leave those in the back at the conclusion of our service today. Our scripture lesson this morning is from the Gospel of John, chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been born blind. His disciples asked him, "Teacher, whose sin caused him to be born blind? Was it his own or his parents' sin?" Jesus answered, "His blindness has nothing to do with his sins or his parents' sins. He is blind so that God's power might be seen at work in him. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." After he said this, Jesus spat on the ground and made some mud with his spittle. And he rubbed the mud on the man's eyes and told him, "Go and wash your face in the pool of Siloam." This name means sent. So the man went, washed his face, and came back seeing. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Okay, so actually let's start today's message by sharing together once again in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the great morning we've already had. And I pray, Lord, that somehow I might be, in a very small way, able to fulfill the expectations of these people in our congregation. Thank you, Father, for the high calling you've given to all of us, and to me especially, to teach and present your word this morning. Bless us today, Lord, and fill our hearts with joy as we share together, and also with conviction and insight, that we might understand what it really means to be salt and light in the world. May we really hear you speak. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. So, that special music from this morning was from the musical Godspell. The movie was filmed in New York City in 1973. I recently refamiliarized myself with the movie and found myself very sad each time I noticed the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center in the background of some of the scenes. And in fact, one of the songs, ironically titled All for the Best, was filmed at the top of the North Tower while it was still under construction. The song we sang this morning was You Are the Light of the World, and is something that in the movie Godspell, the actor who portrayed Jesus told the other members of the cast. Godspell was based on the Gospel of Matthew, and most of the movie was explaining several of the parables Jesus told, using the medium of 1970s music, dance, and dress to appeal to a younger audience. The most famous song from that went high on the secular Billboard charts was called Day by Day. The front of your bulletin today also has an illustration concerning the light of the world. And it says, for as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. The front, and as I read the scripture quotation in the Bible, it clearly dealt with that. So today's message is expanding on that idea. So from Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 and 16, the scripture goes, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they might see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. At one point in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus directed his attention away from the multitude of people and turned to the group of disciples that were closest to him, and he said to them, ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its savor, with what shall it be salted? It is thereafter good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on a lampstand, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Those of us who participated in the Sunday school class that featured the recent film, The Chosen, saw the actors perform this scene with astonishing clarity. As Jesus narrated the Sermon on the Mount, vignettes of his disciples exemplified the various points. In today's scripture, Jesus describes our function as God's people. In one word, it is influence. When we live by the principles of the previous Beatitudes, we will have a profound influence on the world we live in. This is not the impact of government policy or political revolution, but rather the influence of individual character. It is the influence that Jesus wrought upon his world in the first century. It is the influence of both doing and saying. More so than today's modern salt, which is highly refined, the salt available during biblical times had many impurities, which caused it to lose strength and flavor and as a preservative. Once this happened, it was discarded in the streets as opposed to on soil where people might want to grow things, because even though it had lost its strength, salt could still prevent plant growth. So the mention of salt refers to how we can influence the world by setting an example with the way we live our lives. Excuse me. The Welsh Protestant minister and evangelist, Martin Lloyd-Jones, said that most competent historians agreed that England avoided a revolution like that experienced in France at the end of the 18th century. Now, we all know that was famous for the storming of the Bastille and the execution of their king and Marie Antoinette by the guillotine. What undoubtedly saved England from a revolution like that was the evangelical revival that we as Methodists know featured our founder, John Wesley, and his brother Charles. This was not done because anything had been done directly, but because masses of individuals had become Christians, and they were living a better life, and they had a higher outlook. The whole political situation was affected, and the great acts of the English Parliament, which were passed in the last century, were mostly due to the fact that there were such large numbers of individual Christians found in the land. So what he was saying was that they dominated the land by the power of their testimony. It's wonderful to think of the fact that God could turn around a whole nation, and he can turn around a whole world by using us. God uses simple things. You know that. Simple, mundane, everyday, routine, common things for his most amazing purposes. You know, when he made Adam in the garden, he didn't use gold, he didn't use silver, not even iron. He used dirt. That ought to give you, right from the start, kind of an idea of how he worked. When he called David to deliver Israel from the Philistines, he didn't want Saul, the great king. He didn't want Saul's massive armor. Instead, he used a shepherd boy, David, with a sling and a couple of stones. That's all. And when he came into the world, he didn't enter the family of the wealthy and the noble. And we didn't find him born in a castle. Jesus was born in a stable, and God had simply chosen a peasant girl as the mother. And when he chose the 12 disciples, he didn't choose the elite. He didn't choose the educated and the affluent. He just chose a group of ignorant Galileans. And the Bible says, not many mighty and not many noble. And that's the way it's always been, because God gets the greater glory in the humbleness of the one he uses. So he uses us, grains of sand, to influence a corrupting world. But it doesn't stop with just the influence. So now we come to the second thing, and that is the light. Verse 14, you are the light of the world. And so now we move to another thought. Salt and light balance each other in this sense. Salt is hidden. You don't see it at all. It just melts away into whatever it's flavoring or preserves. It works secretly to preserve from the inside. But light shines on the outside, and light is open, and light is working visibly. In other words, the salt is the influence of Christian character. It is quiet, but it is powerful. Light is the communication of the content of the gospel. And so you have both sides. On the one hand, we live it, and on the other hand, we preach it. On one hand, from the inside, we affect society's thinking and society's living by the power of our lives. On the other hand, we turn on the light so that everyone can see the message we want to give. Jesus declared in John 8:12, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. In exactly the same choice of words, he states here that we as his people are the light of the world. This is one of those statements that should cause us to rejoice about our situation in the world. If we are the light of the world, then we must be in the light ourselves. It is a glorious thing to be living in the light and not groping in darkness. Jesus' words are designed to describe not just our blessed position, but our serious responsibility. We not only have received the light of the gospel of Christ, we have become reflectors of that light. The world must see God in us and through us. Again, we notice that Jesus here is not issuing a direct command. He didn't say, go be the light of the world. He said, you are the light of the world. And as with verse 13, the word you has the emphasis in this sentence. You and you alone. As God's people, we are the reflection of his light to the world. The question is whether or not we will allow our light to shine, or will we hide it? Light does not struggle to be noticed when it's introduced into a dark place. Light is the opposite of darkness. Now that seems too obvious to mention, yet there's a prevailing conclusion that God doesn't expect his people to live much differently than the rest of the world. We must strive to coexist because, after all, we're all the same. Well, if we are following Christ, we will expose the darkness of the world we live in. There's a statement about Noah. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for saving his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. Noah did not build an ark to condemn the world. God's light and revelation had already done that. But when he built it, he did condemn the world because light exposes and condemns the darkness. Don't be discouraged if people view your lifestyle as condemning others. It may mean your light is shining bright enough to be noticed. But if we are lights, then we are meant to shine. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. You do not light a lamp and put it under a basket. Jesus' words clearly reject the approach to godly living that sequesters people away in monasteries. God does not want us to isolate ourselves from the world or hide out in a church building, feeling superior to others. We must be seen by others to fulfill our purpose as lights. But we've got to be careful here. This visibility is not about us. As God's people, Israel was a recipient of God's revelation. As people of light, they were to let that light shine in the world, but their obedience was to point people toward God, not themselves. So, Matthew 6, verses 1 and 2 says, "Take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds before men to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward from your Father in heaven. Therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and the streets, that they may have glory from men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets, so that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward." So can others see what God has done or is doing in you? If others cannot see the evidence of God's work, they have no incentive to turn to Him. Can you see the halo above my head? I didn't expect to, and neither did you. So what is this light that Jesus is describing that I must allow to shine in darkness? How do I obey this command? The most powerful method of dispensing light is contained in the text itself, that they may see your good works. Nothing points to God more clearly than doing good. God always does what is good, morally, ethically, and practically. Peter described Jesus in Acts 10:38 as one whom God anointed with the Holy Spirit and power, who went everywhere doing good. Consider Luke's description of the Jerusalem church as they dispensed their light in Acts 2. He says they sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. They were making a favorable impression upon others through their unity and generosity. Now, the most powerful list of good works that shine in a dark world are found in the context of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount itself. This is Jesus' list in that sermon summarized. Does it challenge you enough? 1, work on your heart first. Take sin seriously. Keep your vows. Always tell the truth. Do more than is expected of you. Do good to those that hate you. Don't be a hypocrite. Seek spiritual things over the material things. Don't worry. Trust God. Don't try to pick the speck out of your brother's eye if you have a log in yours. Ask God for everything you need. Follow the truth wherever it leads. And obey God's commands consistently. If I did this, would the world notice me? This is the essence of light in a dark world. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a bushel. I want to close our consideration of this passage with a look at verse 15. Jesus states the obvious. No one intentionally hides a lamp under a basket. It would defeat the purpose and plan of the light. This is the other half of Jesus' implicit command. I must allow my light to shine by not allowing it to be hidden under a basket. So here are some baskets that can hide our light as Christians. Hypocrisy. It's possible to do the right thing, but do it insincerely so as to rob the good work of its light. Jesus did not condemn the Pharisees for keeping the law too carefully, but when they set aside issues of the heart to focus on outward conformity, their example became darkness. Jesus really takes them on in Matthew 23. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayers. Therefore you will receive greater condemnation. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel land and sea to win one proselyte, but when he is won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves. The next basket that can cover our light is fear. Fear is the opposite of faith, and every disciple has been confronted with this light killer. Peter had the opportunity to shine in Jesus' darkest hour, but he was afraid of the words of a servant girl who said, "When you were with him, weren't you one of his followers?" Are you afraid of that darkness? The next basket that can cover our light is worldliness or compromise. Do not love the world or the things in the world. This is from John chapter 2. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. Rudeness could also be a basket that covers our light. Walking wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, so you may know how you might answer each one. Also have to avoid self-righteousness. You think you're right and everyone else is wrong. That covers any light that you may be shedding as a Christian. And finally, a lack of joy. In John 16, Jesus told his disciples that he would give them a joy that the world did not have and could not provide. Do your neighbors see that joy in you, or do they see a murmuring, grumpy person whose bad attitude about life turns them off? In conclusion, is your light shining in this dark world? We are the light of the world. This is our purpose. The book of Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 says, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." If a person is not a Christian, how can he or she lead others out of darkness? People who are not Christians are living in the darkness. What can we as Christians do? First, reaffirm our own faith, and second, invite others to come to the light of the gospel and begin reflecting the glory of God to others. Let us pray. Father God, thank you for bringing us together this morning. Bless us today and throughout the coming week, Lord, and fill our hearts with joy. Let us be salt and light in the world. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, our closing hymn is number 128, "He Leadeth Me." It's also on the screen. Once again, let's stand as able to sing this hymn.
Thank you.
and give you peace. Go forth and do good work. Amen.
Amen.